And wish I could break all the chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things that I should say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole round world to hear. I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart. Remove all the bars that keep us apart. I wish you could know what it means to be me. Then you'd see and agree that every man should be free. I wish I could give all I'm longing to give. I wish I could live like I'm longing to live. I wish I could do all the things that I can do, though I'm way overdue. I'd be starting anew. Well, I wish I could be like a bird in the sky. How sweet it would be if out my heart I could fly. I'd soar to the sun and look down at the sea. Then I'd sing, cause I know, yeah. And I'd sing, cause I know, yeah. Then I'd sing, cause I know, I'd know how it feels. I'd know how it feels to be free. Yeah, yeah, I'd know how it feels. Yes, I'd know how it feels. How it feels to be free.
Right, welcome everyone to the session of the San Diego City College 6th Annual Social Justice Conference. We are so honored and grateful that you are here today to join us for this wonderful, amazing panelist, Leroy Moore. I'm gonna go ahead and just read off some housekeeping items before we get started. Our conference theme this year is Dignity to Dream. And we hope that you continue to dream and manifest social justice out there in the world. I'd like to begin with the land acknowledgement. I like to do these for my classes that I teach. And so I ask you to ground your feet. Here in San Diego, we are on Native Indigenous lands of the Kumeyaay Nation. And so I'd like to really put our intention and focus on being on this land and the people that have stewarded this land. So if you are able to place your hands in front of you, go ahead and do that. If not, just put the intention in the space in front of you. And we take a deep inhale and exhale. Inhale, bring your hands to your heart or bring the intention to your heart. We're just gonna hold a lot of love and compassion for each other and just extending that love to Leroy for being here and sharing us his wisdom. Exhale, opening those hands out or release. Inhale, bring your hands or the intention to your mind. Just taking some knowledge today that you've learned from this session and putting into action. Also to the knowledge you learned today and thinking about what it means to be on Kumeyaay land. Exhale, release that. And then we want to just bring all of the intention and love and minds and bring it to our minds, to our hearts, and to the earth. We recognize that we are on Kumeyaay land, and we hope to figure ways to build bridges and to do more work for the Kumeyaay Nation here in San Diego. All right. We also want to inform you that this session is being recorded. At the latter portion of the session for the Q&A, we may ask you to turn your videos on or be unmuted. And in doing so, you are consenting to being recorded. Otherwise, just stay as you are. The Sankofa Committee, in conjunction with the San Diego City College Social Justice and Education Conference, is committed to creating a space and community that values a collective vision of justice and equity. We aim to amplify voices that have been marginalized as a means to reimagine and enact a more representative and equitable future. Our intent for this conference is to collaboratively build a safer and more inclusive space for our communities. In doing so, we must uphold certain values that leave no space for harmful and disrespectful behavior. Racism, sexism, homophobia, transphobia, ableism, and other forms of violence do not have a place at this conference. In order for this conference to sustain its mission as an event that collectively fosters and inspires a role of social justice in our lives, we must also hold ourselves accountable if we make mistakes. This community includes all of us, and it must be sustained by all of us. You will be asked to leave and remove from the session if you do not uphold and practice these values during the session. We are excited to have Leroy Moore share his stories and expertise today, and we'll have time for questions at the end. You can use the chat feature for questions, or if you'd like to unmute, we can use the raise hand function. And we are grateful to the Diversity Committee in co-sponsoring this session. We also want to remind you this conference is highlighting the crucial work of the organization Think Dignity, whose mission is to inspire, empower, and organize our community to advance basic dignity for those living on the streets. You can listen to Think Dignity's executive director, Michelle Woodson, tomorrow at 2:20. And I've put links in the chat and we'll continue to do so. We also have a survey. We hope you will fill that out and give us some feedback. And now I'm going to hand it off to Ebony Tyree, Professor Ebony Tyree, who will introduce our guest.
Hello, thank you everyone for being here. I just wanna humbly introduce our workshop facilitator today. Leroy F. Moore Jr., founder of the Krip Nation. since the 1990s, has been a key member of a Poor magazine that started with a column in Illin and Chillin for Poor magazine, then onto a founding member of Poor magazine's Homefulness and Decolonize Academy, their school. And so Moore is one of the founding members of National Black Disability, an activist around police brutality against people with disabilities. Leroy has started and helped start organizations like Disability Advocates of Minorities Organizations, to Sins and Ballot, to Krip Hop Nation. His cultural work includes film documentaries, Where is Hope? Police Brutality Against People with Disabilities, spoken word CDs, poetry books, and children's books, Black Disabled Art History 101 course, and published by Zakachel Justice Press. I probably didn't say that right, but Leroy, you can correct that if you'd like. There are a number of links to the work of Mr. Leroy Moore, which we will share in the link as he presents. And you all have your reaction feature there, and you can ask questions in the chat. But if you can use your reactions, let's give a warm welcome with applause or hearts or celebrations to Leroy Moore. Oh, and Leroy, unmute yourself.
Hello, people. Thank you so much for having me. Thanks to the college, and thank all the people that are here today to take time to listen to this old Black disabled man. So thank you so much. Before I go on, I want to tell you what I look like. I'm a Black disabled man with salt and pepper hair, gray hair. I'm in my living room. You can see in the background my pink bike. I love my bike. And I'm wearing a gray and black hoodie. And I'm sitting in a chair in my living room. I'm in Berkeley, California. And I'd also like to take time to, give praise to the indigenous people, in the Bay Area, in California. So once again, a little about me before I head on to the presentation. I was born in the coldest place on earth. It's not the North Pole, it's Buffalo, New York. I grew up in New York and Connecticut in the 70s and 80s. I saw hip hop on the corner before it went mainstream. I was born with a physical disability. It's a part of my identity. I don't believe about overcoming it, but part of my identity, just like race, just like sex. So I grew up as an activist. My father was an activist. My mom fought for services for me back in the 70s. So I grew up as an activist, and I took that on and started doing police brutality activism in the 80s. And it seems like nothing has changed, but here we are. So that's a little about me. I started what's called Krip Hop Nation, and it's an international network of hip hop and musicians with disabilities. We have chapters all over the world. I started with Keith Jones and the late Rob Denoise Temple. Three Black disabled men started Krip Hop, and it's been going ever since. We just did a theme song for the Paralympics that was on Netflix, so you can check that out. I think it's called Phoenix Rising. so you can check that out. So that's Krip Hop. So let's get into the workshop. So the workshop title is Black Disability and Resistance in Creating. Stories, storytelling, songs, poetry, videos, pictures, historical facts, from slave boats to freak shows to the blues to hip hop and to Krip Hop. So what does Black Disabled Resistance look and sound like through time? Through our ancestors' stories, through today's Krip Hop stories and cultural work worldwide, you know, through book readings, and I have a couple books out, and you'll see a couple books that's gonna be part of this presentation, like Black Disabled Ancestors and Black Disabled Art History 101. Those are the two main books that I use sometimes. So, you know, book reading, songs, we're gonna play some songs of Krip Hop and songs from blues singers that were disabled back in the day. We're gonna see some visual arts from Krip Hop, because Krip Hop is more than hip hop, it's visual arts. So we have paintings and drawings from disabled hip hop artists from around the world, from Brazil, from Africa, from the US. So we're gonna show some videos, historical facts, and we're gonna use part of podcasting to show different terminology. So I would love to share this new presentation, you know, showing Black disability resistance and creating from our Black disabled ancestors to today, and it's cultural work in the US and international. So we're gonna start off, in this presentation, most of this is gonna be audio, listening, videos, and pictures. Because I know that I want them to tell their stories. So you're gonna hear some audio interviews or statements. You're also gonna see some videos. You're gonna see some Krip Hop paintings. So first we're gonna start with an audio. It's called Black Disabled Resistance Has Always Been Here. So I did this audio back in, February for Black History Month. And really realizing that Black disability resistance has always been here since we were stolen from Africa and brought to the US. But a lot of people don't know that history. So can we play that audio clip?
Hello, my name is Leroy Moore. And this is Black History Month 2021. It's February the 5th. I want to read what I just wrote, a little statement entitled Black Disabled Resistance. Resistance, brief meaning, the refusal to accept or comply with something. The attempt to prevent something by action or argument. Resistance is more than just fighting back. It also can mean creating other avenues to express ourselves, living without oppression, and holding space for activism, including cultural activism, and more. Black disabled resistance goes all the way back to the creation of the U.S. in every era, from the capture of Africans to slavery to Jim Crow, K
to the blues, to Black Civil Rights Movement, to hip hop. Of course, Black disabled people have lived and contribute to these time periods. And some individuals were resisting not only mainstream white non-disabled society, but also Black non-disabled society. The dozens, blues, Jim Crow, minstrel shows, medicine shows, freak shows, circus, Black arts movement, Black power movement, hip hop and beyond, all had Black disabled individuals who not only contribute, but also resist. That led to platforms of today's cultural expression, like the connection between the dozens, disability and hip hop. Of course, the blind and disabled blues artists all were resisting and creating at the same time. Black disabled resistance continues today inside and outside of the arts and cultural expressions, from Krip Hop Nation, the National Black Disability Coalition, Harry Tubman Coalition, Black Disabled Creatives, Soul Touching Experience, and so much more. Black disabled slash deaf people are still resisting within our own Black community by creating organizations, books, academic classes, visual arts, music, running for political office, offering political education in our own fashion, etc., etc. Black disabled resistance has always been here, and it will always continue as we live and resist in an ableist, racist, sexist, classist, homophobic, and ageist society. This is Leroy Moore. Happy Black History Month. And don't forget, Black disabled resistance has a history, has roots, and it continues today. Peace. Okay, so we're back. Yeah, so, you know, I wanted to put that out, you know, to give some history around Black disabled resistance and, you know, and put that out so people can listen to and hear it. So in that audio, I mentioned the dozens. And when I found out about the dozens, it flipped my mind. I mean, it really flipped my mind. You talking about the connection between slavery, hip hop, and disability. It's all right there. So I want to play this video from KRS-One. KRS-One is an old-time hip-hop artist back in the 80s. And KRS-One talks about the dozens, and you'll hear the connection between disability and the dozens. So let's play that clip.
Some MCs get their notoriety through battling, meaning that back in the days, we used to call it the dozens. Slaves were sold one by one unless there was a defect. Their leg was hurt, an arm was severed, mental issues, maybe sick. Those people were sold in a dozen. So slaves would start going back and forth with each other saying, Well, your head's bigger than your neck, and that makes you a lollipop. Ah, your mother is so this, I could do that. Ah, and everybody would laugh at you, which then eventually became the dozens. So the idea of battling coming out of this tradition called the dozens, where you verbally attack your opponent and your opponent verbally attacks you until somebody breaks down and either wants to fight, cries, whatever it is, or a judge deems the battle won by either opponent. This trickles over into rapping. It was Zulu Nation that first brought up the idea of, we don't have to shoot at each other or beat on each other or this. We can actually use this tradition of the dozens to actually have verbal warfare through art.
Okay, so, you know, like I said, that blew me away when I saw that. And, you know, it's just evidence that, you know, disability has always been there since the beginning. You know, from slaves to the dozens and now hip-hop using that tradition. So if hip-hop is using that tradition, then hip-hop is using people with disabilities in their history, in their struggles, in their resistance, because that is resistance. You know, the dozens was resistance. So, you know, that's a good history to know, you know, especially if you have Black disabled youth growing up, you know, teenager, and, you know, being Black disabled, you know, youth, you know, especially back when I was younger, there was nothing on TV about Black disabled or anything. So now that Krip Hop is here and making those stories, you know, possible and recording them like you're doing today, hopefully Black disabled youth growing up today will see themselves more often. So, you know, coming from the dozens and going to the blues, you know, little history about how I got my foundation as a Black disabled young man is that I was downstairs in my father's basement back in 1979. He had a huge record collection. This was before CDs, of course, you know, before the internet. And, you know, I was down there, I was looking at all his records and I was pulling out records, and every record that I pulled out was a Black disabled singer from the blues, you know, blind blues artists to Walter Jackson, who walked on crutches, you know, so all these people were in my father's record collection. And that was my history. You know, that I, of course, I didn't know it back then, but, you know, I took all these records and I took them to school and I showed the teachers. And of course, the teacher's like, no, we're going to study Beethoven. I was like, oh, come on. But, you know, after I saw that, I was like, okay, this is my foundation. And this proves that Black disabled people have been here and that contributes to society. So this next video is on Charles White, singer, Charles White singer. He was a folk singer back in the 50s and 60s. And he has a great story about him as a young kid being hired to be a guide person for a lot of blind blues. So, and check out that video.
You know, I've never heard my father address my mother other than Mrs. White, or my mother just probably as Mr. White. I guess you'd call it atmosphere of Victorian, but with one difference, music. Like, that morning Josh built the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho,
just fit the band of Jericho. The walls came tumbling down. Now you may talk about your kings of Gideon, talk about your man like Saul, but that's not like the good old Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. Just fit the Battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Just fit the Battle of Jericho. And the walls came tumbling down.
Well, at 8 years old, my life suddenly changed. On my way home from school, I saw a blind man trying to cross the street, and I led him across. He asked me my name. I told him it was Joshua. His name was Big Blind John Henry Arnold. So he sang me a song called Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho, and wanted me to lead him after school. I said, I'll lead you down to the house and ask Mama. He asked my mother, and she said, I have to pray over it. To get the answer from the man upstairs, she did, so a few days later, it was yes. So I got the job, making $4 a week, which was a sitcom with my mother. In those days, that was like a fortune. I left Greenville, South Carolina, and went from city to city, heading south. And all day long, Mr. Arnold would sing, and I would be the tambourine and beg, collect money. And the streets were full of blind singers in those days. And they sang songs mostly like this about themselves, such as a verse of a song like, a blind man stood on the road crying, Jesus, give me back my sight. Crying, Jesus, give me back my sight. Crying, oh, my Lord, save for me. Well, the blind man stood on the road and he cried.
The little.
Okay, I love that video. I love that story. Matter of fact, I had an opportunity to interview his son, and I talked about, you know, that story, and, you know, his son is like, yeah, it's a true story. But, you know, one of my dreams is to go to Mississippi and walk through those blues trails that he walked upon. You know, once again, those stories of Black disabled resistance, you know, stories of Black disabled ancestors. And this is a wonderful story. I think his story as a kid to be a film is a wonderful story. So we're gonna, you know, continue with the videos and continue with ancestors, because like I said, there's, you know, Black disabled ancestors have done so much work. And this video coming up is a Black artist that found out that his, two of his relatives, ancestors, were, conjoined twins. So he's been doing like songs and performance about his ancestors that were conjoined twins. So let's go see that video. Okay, good. So, you know, these three videos, you know, I wanted to show them, and I showed them a lot because those are the foundations of Black disabled history and Black disabled ancestors, and those stories should be told in schools and in college. You know, we had disability courses now, we have Black studies, like disability studies. we have hip hop studies, but in academia, they don't mix. I don't understand. It's like every study is, in their own square box. But Black disability history is Black history, is disability history. So it should be taught in schools more. So going on to another video. This is a video from my book, Black Disability Art History 101. And it started as a poem. And this poem got recognized by two professors at University of San Francisco. And they approached me to do a book called Black Disabled History. And the book came out a couple of years ago, and the professors invited me in to do a class for a whole year by using my book. So let's go to that video, Black Disabled Art History 101. Do you know your Black art history? Well, it's about time you learn. This is called Black Disabled Art History 101. Sit down and listen, because there will be a test at the end. Displaying and speaking our history and culture through music, art, and dance. From slavery to homeland security, Black disabled artists' roots grow deep. However, this garden is starving for recognition. The most famous classical pianist in the mid to late 19th century was a Black blind autistic slave, Tom Wiggins, AKA Blind Tom, was his slave name. His master used him to make money and left him poor and broken. Horace Pippin, the first Black disabled self-taught painter, lost his arm in World War I using his left arm to prop up his right forearm, crafting his first masterpiece depicting horrors of war. Oh, the price he paid for being Black, poor, self-taught, and disabled. Blues is the Black anthem. Attracted blind singers and musicians to make a living on the streets. Some made it into recording studios. Blind Willie McHale, born in 1898, played on the streets of Atlanta. Blind Willie Johnson, born around 1902, a street evangelist. Stepmother threw a lie in young Johnson's eyes, causing blindness. Johnson became the first gospel guitarist to record. He died of pneumonia. Hospital refused to admit him due to his blindness. Blind Blake and Blind Boone's birthdays are unknown. Blind John William Boone formed his own concert company, traveling all over the country, more than 8,000 concerts in the US, Canada, Europe, and Mexico. The most popular male blues recording artist of the 20s was blind Lyman Jefferson. He was also a street performer, danced to the blues, rock, jazz, and hip-hop vibrations under the Wild Zappers, a black deaf dance troupe, feeling the rhythm from the motherland to the chocolate city. Listen to the melody heartbeat of a black deaf woman, Jay's fingers. Read, I'm a proud black deaf woman. Let's travel to Jamaica, where in the 50s, polio affected the island. Skelly, Wise, and Apple are Israel vibration. They met each other at Mona Rehabilitation Center, got kicked out because of their religious belief in Rasta. Homeless, poor, and disabled, began to sing on the streets. Now they are the fathers of reggae. Back to Africa, tribal dancing, to the drumming, guitar strumming, and singing of Abdul and Marim, a blind married couple, blending rock, pop, jazz, and hip hop with an international flavor. From Cuba to Asia, India to America, creeping into the hip hop nation. Paraplegic MC, Fizo, Day, Mad One, and the Black Cripple. Lifting the roof of oppression that suffocates the hip-hop industry. Throwing away the bling bling to create hip-hop, politicalizing our communities. Coming home to the Bay Area to swing from Charles Curtis Blackwell in a bachelor's jazz poetry celebration. So get out your number two pencils for your final on Black Disabled Art History 101. Okay, so that's the video of the book. I'm gonna skip around because I wanna save some time for questions, and there's 1:33 now. So I'm gonna skip around. And we're gonna go to, you know, what is Krip Hop Nation? So this MP3 from Keith Jones is gonna talk about what is Krip Hop Nation. I think I put it in the attachment.
Is it this one, Leroy?
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
Okay. The irony of it is that this is 10 years of something that sprung out of a conversation we had 13 years ago. In Boston, at the Democratic National Committee. And we talked about how, even at the DNC, we went to the Disability Caucus. Oh, we love y'all! We got some good plans. We do! But they didn't say nothing to us for 2 hours. And then we left. And then we bum rushed Ben Affleck, right? And then we went crazy. We was like, look, the DNC don't care about disabled folks. But the conversation was deeper than that. It was how do we affect change with progressive minds? Don't even talk about it. We so woke, but it's not wheelchair accessible. We so woke, it ain't no ASL interpreter. You know, ain't no card report, like, but we woke. How are you sleeping, right? But the point is that we talked about it, and we're like, how do we do it? So he found me on MySpace. Yeah, I'm old. Because don't nobody remember MySpace. Like, it was like Snapchat, Instagram. Yeah. But you couldn't be on MySpace because all your friend requests were like some random porn advertisement. And you never knew who it was. Like, I'm gonna be your friend. No. But we started talking about it, and because we loved hip hop, we grew up with hip hop, we wanted to do that and move the country forward to a real dialogue. Yeah. Because even being black with a disability, black movement has skipped over us. Progressive movement has skipped over us. And that can be applied to any ethnic group when you add a disability to it.
Right.
So we took Krip Hop, and Leroy said, let's do it. I was like, hell yeah.
So that's the beginning of Krip Hop. Keith Jones, he's a co-founder. It's interesting that we started at the DNC 8 years ago when Obama was a new face at the DNC. Really interesting. So we're going to go on to a video that we did this event called Gender Crips, Gender Crip Planet, 2019 in March, to bring together women, non-gender people together that have a disability to talk about their art, their performance. So let's watch that.
Give it up for AJ 420. Yeah.
Yeah. AJ 420. I don't ever need a plan B. You'll see. Sitting in my ride, smoke. Hope the industry don't kill me. Kill me. Cause I know it's what I was meant to be. What I was meant to be. My name is AJ 420. I am a female rapper and I have cerebral palsy. The flow is something you can't learn. Man, I'm in the lane. Swerve like a word. Tonight is basically about like female artists with disabilities expressing themselves, bringing different points of view to music and poetry.
We're here to celebrate a show called Gender Crip Planet, and it's a celebration of women, femmes, and warriors. So it's like non-binary folks, women, celebrating our artwork. And there's a record that came out today. It's called Hell Y'all Ain't Talkin' About, a Crip Hop anthology. This CD really covers the ground that Leroy invited us to do.
I grew up poor and working class, and I'm not ashamed of my past. I've been harmed and I've caused harm. You could blast the trauma alarm sound. Killing me, killing me, killing me.
You know, we can get down behind a lot of the race and class consciousness that comes into hip-hop movement, but there's this disconnect when it comes to ableism and disableism or disability justice. Today is it's just a continuation of the Crip-Hop movement.
The whole point is to bring our story to the forefront that the media doesn't cover and to change the perception of what people with disabilities are about.
I am Queen Nandi, that sister that suffer from PTSD, ADD, ADHD, GOD, or poverty, any kind of DD you can name. I am dyslexic. You cannot judge me because I read my books backwards and I can only understand a map when you turn it upside down. Don't judge me. And I don't look at it as a disability because they are dissing our abilities to stand strong up in this motherfucker. You heard?
Oh.
From the strong queen, her name is Carol X. She was the best. Kick it to me now.
Just want to say my name is Vinny T. I'm on the scene with Pork Magazine, former and always on the edge to be again a welfare queen. Because in this age of gentrification, aggravation, and desecration of our communities, we ain't got no immunity. And that is how we have to be. But oh, no, 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 because homefulness is in the place to be.
I'm Audrey Candycorn, a grieving yet breathing mother. The black woman is a goddess with a little g, no blasphemy. You see, I am the least protected, the most disrespected, but yet I find a way to shine because everything that I need is already inside of me. It's inside of my DNA. You see, I don't have to be the change. I am the change. I simply just have to be.
So that event happened in 2019. The music, the songs on SoundCloud. Just go to SoundCloud, type in Krip Hop on Gender Planet, and you'll see it. So I wanna cut it short here and just open up for questions or comments, or the MC can take it back over.
Thank you so much, Leroy. I think Dr. Grace was working on the technical side to showing your videos. So how we would like for you all to do it, I already see Maxine knows what to do. If you go to the reactions, you can raise your hand. If you have questions for Leroy, I think we will, the chat is enabled. You can chat, I think, either myself or Dr. Grace, if you have questions as well. And we'll be dropping a few links to Leroy's work. Dr. Grace, is there anything you wanted to do before we move? We already have a question up, but is there anything you wanted to say before we let Maxine ask her question?
Just a big thank you to Leroy for educating us and sharing some things that we don't think about often. I was even just thinking about how you described yourself at the beginning of what somebody who may not be able to see could picture. So I appreciate your deep reminders of how we can really kind of look beyond ourselves and to really fight against ableism. So thank you for that reminder. And I really am blessed to be here and listen in on this session. Thank you.
Go ahead, Maxine, and you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, thank you for your presentation, Mr. Moore. It was amazing. I am a BSPS student myself at San Diego City College, and I up against it every day as well. My question to you was, is it possible for you to put in the chat all those different types of Black disabled organizations? Because I would like to get in contact with a few of them.
Yeah.
But thank you. I fight for us too. I started a honor society and disabled club on our campus just to fight the negative stigma of disabled students. So thank you for your presentation. It was amazing.
Yeah, thank you for your work. Keep on doing it. Yeah.
Thank you, Maxine. I did drop some information in the
chat.
Yes, no problem. If there's something I missed, feel free to add. So again, if you have any questions, you can type them in the chat or use the raise hand feature and you can unmute yourself and ask the question or share any comment that you have with Leroy.
We have one in the chat that says, hip hop is frequently criticized for promoting misogyny. Is it also accused of being disrespectful to disabled persons?
We have to be careful when we say hip hop is this or that. You know, hip hop now is totally different when hip hop started. You know, so yes, there's hip hop now that's totally ableist to disabled people. Here in Oakland, we had the Haiti movement, and the Haiti movement used disability lingo, outdated lingo, but did not include people with disabilities. Everybody knows about Drake. I call Drake fake because he became famous by playing a character that got shot in school and was disabled. He carried that character to the stage. And so he has a dance called Wheelchair Jimmy, and it's totally disgusting. It's like, wow. You know, it's almost like bringing back the minstrel shows almost. So yeah, Krip Hop really take aim to hip hop artists that put down disabilities. It's like 50 Cent. 50 Cent should not be on TV anytime soon. He has a history of bullying autistic people. He did it four times. You know, can you imagine if a white person, you know, bullied black people four times? You know, that person would be canceled completely. But 50 Cent continues to make movies and continues to go on. So yeah, there's, you know, there's parts of hip hop that are ableist, and there's other parts that support hip hop. The Sugar Hill Gang, one of the first hip hop groups, you know, supports hip hop. DMC from Run-DMC supports hip hop. We interviewed him twice. So yeah, so there's parts of hip hop that are ableist, and there's also parts of hip hop that continue to support us.
We have another one in the chat that says, "Thank you, Leroy. You broadened my knowledge about Black disability. I never thought of the history of music like the blues like that before. Great presentation."
Thank you.
Anyone else would like to ask a question or even like to be unmuted to speak?
I could, I want to comment something. So I think it's really powerful, like about everything that Leroy shared, because we often don't think about the voices that are silent. Maybe he's like the voice for all of the people that have disabilities, and they feel like vulnerable because they can't like fight. But like him, like he has a disability and he's like, pushing forward, you know? So it's like a great example for others to follow. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think, you know, at age 54, it's all about leaving a foundation for the next generation. One thing that Krip Hop is planning to do, and we're so excited, is to have a Krip Hop Institute. So we're going to take over a building where we have a Krip Hop art gallery, we have a Krip Hop studio, we have a Krip Hop international room with all computer screens, so chapters can talk to each other. So this Krip Hop Institute will be a place where little Leroys can come and see themselves. Because growing up in New York, I went to so many museums like, I didn't see myself, you know? So this is gonna be an opportunity where disabled people, Black disabled people, youth, you know, parents can come and, you know, educate themselves and have a mirror for their children. So we're looking for buildings to purchase. You know, I think it's gonna be here in Berkeley or LA. So if people know a building and if they have deep pockets, they can buy us a building, you know, let us know. Any other questions?
That's beautiful. I think folks, you know, are just absorbing, you know, and listening. Someone, there was a question in the chat about your work. So I dropped some information in there about your works and documentaries and the publications that you have. There's also, I think, an email there if folks want to follow you. Do you do any social media, Leroy?
Oh yeah. I'm always on Facebook. Matter of fact, last week, Krip had our first Africa chapter meeting. So we had Krip chapters on Uganda, South Africa, the Congo. We all met on Zoom, we all met on Facebook. So my handles is, Leroy Moore on Facebook. Krip Hop everywhere with a K, Black Krip anywhere. So yeah, just Google it and it'll show up.
Well, thank you. I think we want to, Dr. Grace, is there anything else? I think there's another session after, is there a 2:20? Yeah.
Yes, we have one more session today. One is We All We Got, San Diego Mutual Aid. And the other one is a veterans panel. And that is all on the website. I can post that in the chat as well.
So we'll do that. And if we can, again, with your reactions, let's please show Leroy Moore some love. Hearts and applause and celebrations and the reaction button. It means something. We know you are here. We know you are present. And we really appreciate you sharing so much with us today, Leroy. I've learned a lot and I'm thankful.
Yeah, thank you, Ebony. And thank you, Dr. Grace. Thanks for having me. And good luck for the rest of the conference.
Thank you.
Thank you,
everyone.
Bye.
Bye, Leroy. Well, Dr. Grace, I don't know if I'm